In this session, let us also continue with an additional information that we get from the story of two Jewish men visiting Kanchi Acharya. They ask the question, what is the first language or the mother of all languages that evolved? Kanchi Acharya's answer was, it is the Deva Bhasha, the language of the Devas. Actually, that language is referred as Chandas. This language usage has got forgotten over a period of time. So, he says Chandas has all the vibrations and sounds for communication, which actually was understood and can be easily used by people of certain spiritual strength or intelligence. Actually, from this Chandas, 24 or 32 main languages evolved across the world, so that it takes care of the climatic, food and cultural habits, because the tongue would be very different across the world. So, let us remember, for example, this, that Chandas is the mother of all languages. There is even reference to the Chandas in the works of Panini's Ashtadhyayi. Now, we want a sturdy language into which the Vedas must be put in so that it's preserved. This is where they say somewhere between 25,000 to 35,000-40,000 years back, the Sanskrit as a language evolved first. The word Sanskrit means it is Samkrita, well constructed, well done or well formulated. So, the Vedas have been documented into Sanskrit because it was a language that evolved first or in good old times, from the Chandas language. And equally, if you find in southern part of India, they use a language which is normally known as Grantham. The Grantha Lipi letters look very similar or equivalent of Tamil letters, with variation of letters from Malayalam also. You can say Grantham would have come as a combination of Tamil and Malayalam. Some Vedic experts, Ganapadis whom I meet, or those who run Patashalas have told me, the Grantha language is older than Sanskrit. So, it was an effort to preserve the Vedas as well as bring in a well-constructed language. Sanskrit has come in. The greatness of Sanskrit as per the scholars is that Sanskrit is the least ambiguous language, and for a specific context, a specific meaning can be used. Especially in Vedas, one needs to be aware of the contextual meaning of the word that gets used. For example, a sentence formed in Sanskrit, if the subject, predicate, objects, whatever gets changed, still it will give same meaning. For example, they say Ramaha Shivam Namati. He says Rama worships Shiva. So, it can be changed to, if you just write it as Shivam Ramaha Namati, Namati Ramaha Shivam, like this, even if you put it in different order, it gives the same meaning, but there will be minor changes to the grammar. But basically, as it is written, the basic words, whatever way it gets changed, gives the same meaning. Now, Sanskrit is such a powerful language. A research scholar who worked on languages as well as computers had written a major research project in 1986-87 that Sanskrit properly developed and applied can become an universal operating system for the computers. The Western scholars have taken a lot of interest in Sanskrit, especially Germany. There are courses in Sanskrit, Indology, on a very structured basis in German universities for quite a long time. And when you say Germany, we all remember Max Müller for his love of Sanskrit and the Vedic and related sciences and aspects of India. Modern research, if you read certain articles, it says the Sanskrit has got a very good effect on the body and the mind and the way a person can shape himself. This is normally called as a Sanskrit effect by the Westerners. So you recently you would have, you know, come across news that the education minister of England wanted Sanskrit to be introduced in the schools. So this is something we normally in India think that Sanskrit is a language only for performing our pujas or recital of Vedas. We are slightly, you know, we are mistaken or we have missed the bus not learning the Sanskrit because of foreign invasion, the rule. Because I read some article which says there were close to 5,400 patashalas which BMB teaching in Granthalipi as well as Sanskrit. Now it has come down to around about 1,500. There may be additional informal schools, but Sanskrit as a powerful language was ideal to, you know, give place to that, you know, documentation of Vedas. Now, Grantha Lipi, which is used in the south, has equivalent class or letter representation that will give the pronunciation will rightly give the effect of the sounds and the vibration intended by the Vedas. So, around the time the Kali Yuga started, somewhere around close to 5,075 years or something as of current year, sage Vyasa compiled the Vedas and handed over to, made it into really four divisions of Veda. He was worried. He was very much a saintly as well as a person. He is considered as the avatar or reincarnation of Vishnu. That right from the Kali Yuga, people will start concentrating on their personal benefit, material benefits, money. The interest on spiritual matters and the interest in Vedas may go down eventually. So he thought it right to make the proper divisions. He handed over the Rig Veda to Baila Rishi, Yajur Veda to Vaishampayana Rishi, Sama Veda to Jaimini Rishi and Atharva Veda to Sumanta Rishi. This is what we normally get it from the books. Now, if these are not watertight compartment amongst the four Vedas, let us get that clear. The same Veda mantras are found across these four Veda divisions. But many times we see the main source of these mantras are from Rig Veda. Each of these Vedas have their own mantras attributable to a rishi or maybe sometimes even a group of rishis. The rendering style swaram rules differ between the four Vedas. For example, in traditional Rig Veda, when we say Agnimi le prokidam yajnasya devam ridvijam kodaram ratna dadamam. This is, I understand this explanation, so I am giving stress on the dadamam. Instead of rising it to swaritam, the is elongated. These kind of styles are there in olden languages like Greek. But there are some schools of Rig Veda which recite it similar to what Yajurvedis would do. Veda VMS as a group, we have not much knowledge of the other sections. We have learnt only Krishna Yajurveda. So if you have doubts, I would request you to contact certain gurus from the other sections of the Vedas. Atharva Veda is said to be a later evolution, but on reading a translation book, Atharva Veda covers lot of details about householders' living practices, rules and regulations. And one key aspect of this Atharva Veda is Atharva Veda deals quite a lot about plants and their curative properties for various ailments, diseases. Unfortunately, there has been, due to foreign invasion, burning libraries, killing of pandits, India has lost quite a bit of Vedic material and knowledge during the foreign invasion. Kanchi Acharya says one thing is very clearly is that Atharva Veda source material has left India nearly 400 years back. This 400 years suggests that it is the time when the Mughal Empire was coming to an end and the British rule has started slowly spreading in India. So, this material could have gone anywhere and the details there could be used, say for example, for medicine by any person interested in Eastern medicine, look at the properties and chemicals and maybe apply it through modern allopathic medicines also.